please be reminded that once the show starts, if you plan on talking, if you feel like singing, and if you can't stop dancing,
then you're in the right place.
We are the Boogie Loves.
And it's time for all you kids to get out of your seats and join us.
Join Goofy, Susie, and me, Toofy, for a whole new interactive movie-going experience where singing along, dancing along, and playing along are all part of the movie fun.
Just give me that oogie love.
Oh, my oogie God.
Oogie love. You are my oogie love.
Oogie love.
Boy, yeah, if only these songs that we were singing were in the movie instead of what I had to hear.
No.
Co-host, I was flip-flopping the whole time between the movie because you said you have to go see this. And I was going to do it anyway because this is just too fucking good to pass up.
I'm upset you guys left me out. I wish you'd done it over the weekend.
No, I told you, but I mean, I know you got other things to do, but I wish we could have had time to let you go see it. I mean, this movie came out last week. I mean, that's why it's like, we got to get to it before the movie's out of the goddamn theater,
it is
which will be tomorrow. Yeah.
It is. We're recording this on a Wednesday, but you have about 24 hours less, actually, to go catch this on the big screen
the next season of 24. I'm trying to get to see Oogie Love.
I'm reading news reports like as of yesterday where theaters were thinking, okay, we don't need to show this movie at our establishment. We just don't need it. It's not making any money, so why are we showing it?
Yeah, you don't need to show it until my dumb ass comes up to the box office saying, one for Oogie Love, please.
I'm sorry, what did you just say?
No,
I want to see that movie, Oogie Loves. Oh, forgot we had that.
Oh, man, for a situation like this, they're trained to be like workers at a sex theater where you come up and ask for a ticket, and you know the person behind the box office is probably thinking, look at this fucking pervert. But they're trained to be polite and say, okay, sure, enjoy the show.
Absolutely right. When I went to go, because I saw the trailer. I saw the trailer online because I read about how badly the movie had done over the weekend.
Right.
How it's like, I think it's considered like, it is the worst movie along with it's made the less the box office is like sad.
It's pathetic. It roughly made about $450,000 on its debut over the week, this past weekend.
Yeah.
And that is the lowest opening for a movie to open on over 2,000 theaters. Why Oogie Loves is on 2,000 theaters, I don't fucking know. Yeah. And if you want to get exact, it opened up on 2,160 theaters. Now, I don't know what kind of fucking curse is out there, but in 2008, there was a movie called Delgo, which was the worst. Delgo, a movie. It was an animated movie.
Animated movie about a dog?
No. You're thinking about
Diego.
I know what you're thinking about. No, Diego's about a horse.
Oh,
you're thinking about Fargo.
I'm thinking about Balto. Okay.
No, I knew you're thinking about. That's the one, Balto. No, Delgo was this science fiction something on another world that nobody gave a fuck about, and it was an animated movie. Opened in 2008. Guess how many theaters it opened up in? 2,160. And it was the worst opening for a movie in over 2,000 theaters at that time. Until lo and behold, the Oogie Love said, you will not stand by. We will break that record. We will not stand for this.
No, you're absolutely right as far as just going in there, like going to the box office. There's a girl working in the box office. And I was, you know, I know it's a movie for like children. So I was like, yeah, went for Oogie Loves. And this girl did not look at me. She did not do anything except push buttons on a computer. Didn't even say enjoy the movie. Just gave it to me without looking at me, just in case the cops come to pull me out of the theater. She has no idea. She doesn't need to get involved. But man, it is embarrassing when you are in the theater alone at first. You're like, oh God, there's nobody in here. No wonder. There's nobody in there. And then a mother and her child walks in. And throughout the movie, this child is singing and dancing while, because you can't help but look over where your kid is screaming and dancing. And I look over just because it startles me whenever it happens. And the mother is giving me the stink eye. Like, what are you doing in here hanging out with me and my daughter while she's dancing and singing?
Honey, dance on this side of mommy.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Well, at least you got that. I was in the theater by myself.
You lucky bastard.
Which adds a certain air of comfort there, which is okay, but you still have to get past the person working the box office who is saying, you are the only one coming to see this movie. We didn't even have to strain this thing. We were going to have a cigarette break. We were getting ready to go get some pizza. And you grown motherfucker came in here to watch this, but you don't even have a kid with you.
We had to call the projectionist who's in the bathroom taking a shit right now to go start up that goddamn film.
Honestly, I'm surprised the manager didn't come out and go like, pal, give me a break. Don't make me waste a bulb. This thing. No. Look, I'll give you some free popcorn.
That's when you go
watch The Dark Knight.
Hey, look. Hey, dude. Here's $10 to get the fuck out of here, okay?
Yeah, I know.
I'm losing money on this movie.
Here's 20. I'll send you the DVD.
Honest with you. We didn't even thread this movie.
Okay. But I was in there by myself except for the guy who came up to mop after me after I left. They said, you going to walk in here like a guy at a porn theater? We're going to treat it like that.
Yeah.
Get the sticky floors all clean and shit. I'm not jacking off to the Oogie loves them. We don't care. We're gonna make you feel like you did. But
so how awesome was it?
But here's the deal, man. This movie holds another record besides what I just told you.
Oh, what's that?
It is the record for undoubtedly, inarguably, the weirdest fucking theater experience I have ever had. I'm telling you, this is. David Lynch can't make shit like this.
No. I mean, when I was in that theater too, I was like, wow, this is what people who start to slowly go insane start to feel like, where you're like, you're constantly like laughing just at the ridiculousness of it. And then halfway through, your laughing starts to become crying, and you're like, and you got a kid.
It goes from like a chuckle to a maniacal laugh.
To a maniacal laugh, and you've got a child that's laughing right there on your shoulder with you.
Yeah,
and you're like, what the fuck is going on here with this film?
Yeah, it really is. It really is if somebody told David Lynch, hey, man, here's $20 million. Go make a children's film. Mm-hmm. And he comes back with this. Check this out. This is the story. And I'll elaborate on this after I tell you what it is. So the Oogie Loves are the best way to describe them are creatures. They look like if somebody combined, like cloned, like if you had a Cabbage Patch Kid about to like teleport, but a fucking lizard got caught in the teleport chamber and they got fused together. That's what they look like. And they have these soulless dead eyes. And whenever they talk, the mouth doesn't move correctly with what's being said.
Is it foreign? Is that what it is?
No, I don't know. I don't know. I'll tell you about that in a little while. But anyway, they're fucking huge, but they're obviously childlike. And they play in a band. And they're playing all this music and everything. And they say, oh, wait a minute. We forgot. We got to throw a surprise party for our talking pillow Schluffy, who is asleep through the whole movie. You know, which is like, wow, why can I be a fucking talking pillow right now?
I was like, wow, he's the lucky one.
So they're about to throw this surprise party. But they say, we got to wait for the balloons being brought in by J. Edgar. What is J. Edgar? A vacuum cleaner.
He's a vacuum cleaner. He's J. Edgar Hoover. Yeah. Vacuum cleaner.
So J. Edgar is going down out in public, just going down the sidewalk with five balloons in his hand.
Dressing in women's clothing.
And it was voiced by Leonardo DiCaprio. No, it wasn't. I don't know who the fuck did the voice. I don't know who any of these people except for the
cameo. Walking down the road with my balloons. Yeah. Can't wait for the party.
Mother.
No, but you know... But he falls and lets go of the five balloons. And when they get back, when he gets back to the Oogie Cave or whatever the place where they're the Oogie Cottage or whatever they're in.
The Oogies eat them.
Yeah.
Where the fuck are our balloons?
Yeah, they're like, hey, man, we can have a party. Where are those fucking balloons we sent you to get? And he's like, I'm sorry. I tripped and I forgot. They're like, oh, shit, we got to go out and get these balloons back. It won't be a party unless we have these golden balloons. And J. Edgar's like, well, let me go help you guys. But then there's... a talking mirror with a southern accent who's making flirty eyes at J. Edgar and say, hey, J. Edgar, why don't you stay here and keep me company? It's like, what the fuck is happening?
I am tripping more than one way.
Yeah, and by the way, the mirror has a real face. Teletubbies ain't got shit on this movie right here. So they go out to find these five balloons. And let me just say that.
I'm sorry. Maybe I got lost.
No, you didn't. No, you didn't. And when they go out to find these five balloons, well, let's just say that with every balloon that they find, a little bit of a B-list, a C-list, or even D-list actor's career dies because every balloon they find There is this cameo by a celebrity there.
Yeah, these balloons end up at everyone's doorstep who's about to enter celebrity rehab. I mean, there's five of them along with we got Toni Braxton.
Well, the first one they run into is Cloris Leachman, who plays a woman named Dottie who loves dots, mm-hmm. along with her granddaughter who loves squares. And then they move on to the next cameo appearance, which is Toni Braxton as a singer who's hanging out at an airport about to go on her world tour. The third person they run into is
my favorite.
What's his name?
Chaz Palminteri,
who plays a guy who owns a milkshake shop, who says things like, "Hey, daddy, oh," and "ooh."
He steals that guy from Car 54 that goes, "ooh, ooh, ooh."
Oh, yeah.
He steals it. He's like my favorite. He's one of my favorite characters. I have two characters in here that are my all-time favorites, but he is one of them. He plays Marvin the milkshake guy.
Yeah.
And he's like, everything is like, "Hey, what do you want? Ooh, that's my favorite."
Yeah.
"I'd like sweet pickle, dill pickle, warm pickle, chill pickle, please."
"Ooh. My favorite.
I could use some fish to Bismol right now."
They're like, "Hey, you," because everybody has these balloons. He's like, "Hey, I can't just give you that balloon, daddy. Yo, ooh, you gotta participate in the milkshake contest.
There's a milkshake going on. There's a milkshake contest going on. Ooh, and you got to enter. Ooh."
He was happy
to
be in this movie. I mean, that's why I didn't know what to think about this. I thought, okay, you know what? He's being a professional actor. He's pouring himself into this. He putting everything he has into this. But at the same time, I'm thinking like, but he's putting his all into Oogie Loves.
I know.
It made me sad at the same time.
That's what makes him a professional. That's what makes him a professional. It's just another gig. He has to put his all. Just when you hear him even sing the songs, Leon, he puts his heart and soul. He's like, I mean, there was a part where it's like at the end of the song, he's like, "Corey, Leon, I just want to make you a milkshake tonight."
Boy, he was happy to get that paycheck, boy.
He was.
That motherfucker went to the bank. 100 Oogie Bucks. Ooh,
yeah. along with 100 Oogie Give milkshakes, my favorite.
Then the other two that are remaining,
y'all are scaring.
It gets worse. Wait a minute. You think, how crazy can it get? They run to Carrie Elwes, who's walking, who's a cowboy, who's blowing bubbles everywhere, who's talking, who's walking like he bobbles like he has a stick up his ass.
No, he looks
like he's constipated.
He walks like he fucking accidentally sat on a goddamn bubble machine maker, and that shit is still blowing bubbles out from his ass to his mouth.
Yeah.
And he looked like a white version of Cowboy Curtis. That's what
he looked like.
And he's walking like he just got, like, he has bow-legged. Something up his ass.
He's bow-legged, I'm telling you. Like somebody just fucked the shit out of him in his ass.
Maybe he's Jake Gyllenhaal from Brokeback Mountain.
They broke his ass in. And he's walking like he just got raped in the ass and is traumatized over it.
Because
he comes out, he's like, "I love balloons. Hey, I'm sorry, I love bubbles. You know what? I'll help you get your balloon partner." And it's like, okay, what the fuck can they do to top this?
Yeah.
And they do. Two celebrities they run into are Christopher Lloyd and what's the name? Jamie Presley.
Yeah.
And I know I always make this joke where I say, "Oh, this person in this movie. You see how crazy this person look like they kidnapped this person, drugged them, and put them in this film." But it really looks like they did that to Christopher Lloyd, because all he does is sit there and play bongos, and he only has two lines. One of them being, "Oogie."
Yeah, I know.
I know you can't follow this. I know this sounds crazy, Leon, but this is what we witnessed. I am not exaggerating a beat here.
No, you are not. I mean, it is one of those films when you're watching it and you're like, "Wow, I know this is directed towards kids, but this is like a Teletubbies' worst nightmare coming true when you're watching it."
Teletubbies, like,
if they have nightmares, this is it.
It's crazy, man. And you know, I can understand how this could be some innocent entertainment for kids. I mean, most of our drug problems, I realize, are caused by shit like this now. This is
true.
Why it started out with H.R. Puff and stuff, and it just got crazy since then. We are potheads because we are trying to relive our childhood fantasy. We're trying to get back to that fucking crazy place with all these puppets and stuffed animals and shit.
And when you're exposing children to this, especially like that little girl who lost her shit, she had a big fucking cup of something, of Coke or something, because she spilled that shit all over the floor. Like, she started dancing, and I heard this kabloosh, and I was like, "Whoa, what the hell?" And she's going, "Yeah!" And she's screaming and dancing, and because that's, if you didn't know, that's encouraged by the movie. In the movie, they're like, "All right, kids, if you're sitting down, time to get up and start singing with us."
Oh yeah, they have butterflies. They tell you to do two things. Whenever you see butterflies cross the bottom of the screen, get up and dance with the Oogies. Or when you see the Turtles, that's when you sit your ass back down. And
Leon, this shit, I mean, that girl was tripping balls, dude. I'm serious. And just to let you know, the inspiration from this movie, and I was curious. I looked it up, and the inspiration of this movie came from the director. What's the director's name?
Well,
the director's name is Ken Weiselman.
Actually, he's not the director.
He's not the director.
No, he's
he's the producer.
He's the producer of Teletubbies.
Yeah. Okay, well,
And I think he said, well, shit, everybody bought into that crazy Teletubby shit, which I was high when I made up with when I came up with that. Oh, they'll love the Oogie Loves.
That guy, he went to a screening of Madea Goes to Jail, and he noticed how the audience that he was with, which we can all imagine who that was, he was amazed by the audience participation of that movie, with people hollering at the screen, getting up out of their seats, going nuts. He looked at that, and he was like, I need to do something where the audience actually gets to participate in the movie, and I'll do something like I did with Teletubbies with it. And that was his inspiration to get this to the big screen.
You know what he should do then? Make a movie where black people come to it. Because they participate with every fucking movie they see.
Shit. I was like, Tyler Perry need to get together and like work on something.
Make a Oogie Madea?
Yeah. I mean, Madea already looks like a goddamn Oogie Love.
I love that he would go to see a Madea movie with that audience, and that's all he could pull away from it.
And
it was like, well, clearly, the audience wants to get involved.
Oh, the movie was driving me fucking insane, man, because they had those turtles and those fucking butterflies on the screen.
How much did you get up and dance?
You
were there by yourself.
I was the only one there, so I kind of...
I tell you what, I got up and fucking danced during the Chaz Palminteri song, because that is the best fucking song. I downloaded that on iTunes right after I saw it, because the song's all about him making a milkshake. He's like, this is milkshakes are real fun. Here's how you get it done. You chop them up. Chop them, and then he goes, like, and then bleed. And then the whole song is him describing that.
Oh, I thought you were joking. You serious?
No, we are
serious about this. And hey, man, you know, I'm in there by myself. I kind of felt like, well, shit, I'm here. I'm gonna make this worth my time. I got up and danced my ass off until a roach walked by and shook his head at me like, Jesus, man.
The roach came over and told him to sit down.
Yeah.
Said, sit your ass down.
The kids, we'll move to the next theater. There's obviously perverts in here. Yeah. But the movie was driving me fucking crazy, man, because they got that going on, asking you to get up and dance the whole time. I'm like, all right, I can see that. I can be with that for a little bit. But then they have one of the Oogies named Toofy, Toofy Oogie, and they're telling you, kids, every time Toofy's pants fall down, say, Goofy, Toofy, pick your pants up. And I'm just like, God damn, get this motherfucker a belt or some rope or something, because I'm sick of his pants falling down. I'll be looking like he's gangster Oogie and shit, man.
I was waiting for his, like, yellow dick to come out or something.
Yeah.
I was like, this is a kid's movie. Why is this guy's pants always falling off every 10
minutes? Why is this motherfucker sitting up here looking like Snoop Dogg and shit with his pants halfway down? God damn, man. Got a crack of his ass. Showing
no
his,
shit.
Getting he's that like, gangster lean and
I
shit.
I don't wear belts. Belts aren't cool. Ooh.
Yeah.
That's like his reasoning.
Well, motherfucker, get some suspenders or something.
But just seeing like Jamie Presley and Doc fucking Christopher Lloyd, Doc Brown playing Mexicans, that was
That was kind of offensive.
Wait. Blondie Jamie Presley is playing a Mexican.
By the way, they did not try to dye her hair black. They just said, well, she ain't really from Mexico. She's from Spain. So, yeah. You know, but each everywhere they go, they have to do something to get the balloon. Like at the milkshake place, they have to drink milkshakes to win the balloon back. They have to do a dance and make this treehouse go around so fast so they can make the balloon drop or something. Here at this,
it's a windmill they got to get.
Christopher Lloyd and Jamie Presley, they have to do like sort of
the cucaracha.
Dances and shit to make the windmill like fly real high.
In order to get to the windmill, they have to summon a giant sombrero, which is a sombrero / spaceship that they get into. They start to do the Macarena. The power of the Macarena puts this sombrero into flight. So they're encouraging kids to dance to this fucking song. And the more you dance, the louder you get, the faster this sombrero will go, while you have fucking Christopher Lloyd playing bongos with his crazy fucking hair, looking like he's stealing Matthew McConaughey's job.
Say, is he at least naked when he plays the bongos?
No, hell no.
But I mean, the problem with it though is, if you're a normal person watching this movie, the repetition of it, it's like, it's pretty much the same setup. They go, they encounter these crazy fucking people to get the balloon, and each of them have to have a song number that you're going to have to go through each time. And then they start to tell you, this is when the song ends, this is when it, and this is when you get up, or this is when you sit down. But it's so repetitious that it's just like a bunch of sequences. They could have all, it's all the same plot. Nothing, you're not learning anything from this. You're not really getting anything from the characters. There's nothing there to have the kids learn anything. I mean, yeah, it's just ridiculous.
Leon, I never understood. I never understood the purpose of Teletubbies. Whenever they said repetition teaches these kids something, I don't. Let me just say, when I saw Teletubbies, it looked like a show for retarded kids.
Teletubbies is for the youngest of young kids. There is that repetition. There's bright colors. It's about keeping them calm. They'll watch it. Teletubbies is about chilling out and just having fun with your friends. Like it teaches them like the basics of friendship.
Well, combined with what you and co-hosts are saying, see, that's what the problem is with this movie. We're talking about a movie that is an hour and a half for toddlers. Now, this would work perfect. I have no problem with this being something on that's 30 minutes on TV. Shit, I'll light up a joint and watch it myself. You know, I don't care. But when you put this in a movie theater, I don't know what they were expecting with this. I guess now it becomes clear that this guy Ken Bisonman, whatever. I see what he was probably thinking. He probably thought, because there was a lot of money invested in this. Not maybe for them, not a whole lot. It's, if you really look at it, it's $60 million total. $20 what the movie cost, and put another $40 into promotion. So
it cost $20 million.
So it cost $20 million to make. Hey, those fucking Oogies, though, they ain't cheap to make.
But you wouldn't tell. You really can't tell, because I don't know. If I was curious. I wanted to ask you, the screen that you went to, did it look like they were just projecting something on TV onto the screen?
Well, no, that's the other thing, man. It's a television production, and it really is. It's a television production that had this budget multiplied by making a movie. Now this
so, were they using Access TV effects?
No. It
looked like a found footage film to me. It looked like some shit they found buried underneath the.
Well, the reason why it looks so cheap is because it's a $20 million movie, which a $20 million budget should have went into like investing in a bunch of straight to DVD videos that parents could buy.
Yeah.
Because I'm telling you now. Any parent who goes to see this movie, you might love your kid, but you're going to really become close to abandoning your kid. You're going to be like, hey, kid, you know, daddy's going next door to get a beer. You all right, kid? All right?
Your
kid could be 3 years old. You're going to leave him. You're going to leave his ass there.
You're either going to abandon them or eat them. One or the other.
Or slap the shit out of you. Don't you ever do that to daddy again. But you know, it just seems baffling to me. I understand what they were thinking. They're thinking, okay, we're going to make this for preschoolers. It's going to be crowd participation. We might have something here that we can release periodically in theaters, and then we can probably bank twice as much. We got that money coming in, creating a phenomenon theatrically, and then we got money coming in from DVD sales and whatever home releases we can do. But it doesn't work that way. They failed to see that this is something that no one is interested in, mainly because no one knows what the fuck an Oogie Love is. Yeah. That's the biggest problem.
It's not an established property. And the thing is that, you know, you can't invest kids into something that they're not familiar with. It just doesn't work that way. I mean, unless you have a name like Pixar, sure, because that's a name families, people can trust. But when you barely have any advertising for something like this, especially where, you know, you're going to get toddlers and kids, where I'm like, this is the wrong year to put it out, because at this point, parents are getting their kids ready for school, for pre-K. When are they going to have time to go see the Oogie Love?
I looked up Oogie Love on the internet to see, oh, where did this come from? Who knows about this? Don't nobody know what the fucking Oogie Love is. No one. So when it's not established like Teletubbies. They would have been better off doing a Teletubbies movie instead of trying to do something like this.
I wish.
So, combined with them not knowing what the hell an Oogie Love is, and this being something that's for toddlers that should be 30 minutes at the most on goddamn TV, this is a fantastic failure.
So, well, I don't know. Could be a success as far as tax write-off or money laundering?
Sure. Hey, okay. Yeah, you know what? That makes a lot of fucking sense. Yeah, and I'm sure it would make sense if it was some kind of drug cartel. Yeah, like using this to money launder.
You got a storage locker full of cash from all the meth you cooked. Yeah. And you need a way to launder that money.
It's always great to get the customers of your product in your movie. You know?
Yeah. Hey, look,
it's so easy.
If you got an Oogie carrying meth or cocaine in his ass, bringing it to you, then I can understand that a little bit better. But
the thing is, you say like, you know, somebody. Nobody thought about the fact that nobody knows what Oogies are, but somebody thought about it because I never saw one single ad or trailer for this.
So
whoever was in charge of promoting it looked at it and went, fuck no.
Why do you think it's being released now?
Yeah, really? Yeah, no, it's I never saw anything about it. I saw a poster in the movie lobby and I thought, that's a standee for like some new candy that they have.
Right.
The only thing that made me like go and look it up and even look at the trailer is I saw it in the same sentence I saw Teletubbies. And I was like, okay, I got to see this. What the fuck is this? And when you're looking at it, you're like, yeah, this is from the same crazy guy who brought you Teletubbies. And it's one of those things where, you know, even if you are stoned watching this movie, I don't know how much enjoyment you can get out of it after the repetition. Because as much as I was like, wow, this is an experience from hell. Yet, I mean, I felt like Alex, where somebody was, where you have that sensation that your eyes are starting to burn and you're begging for teardrops and you're telling somebody, all right, this is, I've already seen enough. I'm much better now. Yeah. You know, and it just doesn't happen because when you want the movie to end, especially when you feel like you've got enough craziness, it doesn't want to end. And you just feel like, oh, God, there's one more fucking balloon. By the way, when they find these balloons have the creepiest fucking stone.
Oh, they come to life.
Yeah, they come to life. They have like this Keanu Reeves smile from like Bill and Ted where he just, hey, I knew you'd find me. I'm like, are these fucking, are these balloons filled with nitrous? And it gets, what is going on?
And it gets,
it sounds like you would just call your drug dealer up and just like, man, lose my number because your shit's not good.
I don't need your drugs anymore. I have this movie.
That is the new criteria for drugs. Yeah. Hey man, if I take this, will I see Oogie Loves? Because I don't want it if I don't. No, because there's even a point where they fucking up these kids' minds so bad. Because at a point where they tell these kids, they're like, "Hey kids, we got all five balloons, but that still ain't enough. The true power to get these balloons back is love. Blow kisses at the screen.
Blow them kisses. And you know what? At the end of that, I found myself blowing goddamn kisses. And I was like, "What am I doing?
Oh, no,
I can't stop."
Shit, at the end of that, I found myself blowing my fucking brains out.
I went from blowing kisses to sucking dick somehow. I don't know how that happened.
Hey, kid. Hey, that'd be funny talking to you. Yeah. Hey, co-host. Yeah. The only way we can get back is if you blow the guy next to you.
I'll do it. Blow faster.
Why'd you say that in the first place?
I've been waiting all day for this.
I felt like Dorothy this whole time.
Right.
I was here all the time. The penis was here all the time. Man, I can finally go home. I got to tell you, it boils down to this. I want to be kind on this movie because, like I said, for kids, who 3 years old, why wouldn't you love this crazy shit, man? This is heroin for kids.
Yes,
This is LSD for like kids who are 3-4 years old.
That little girl in the theater was a testament to that. I can at least say that. I was like, wow, it is fucking having an effect on this kid because this kid is going batshit crazy right now.
Yeah, I mean, they had it's a great idea for a DVD, as I keep saying. Listen, I'm behind this property 100%, except that you had the balls. I don't know if I should say that was bold or that was stupid, but you tried.
It could be both.
It could be a little bit both. You tried, you failed, and it's just a baffling business decision that I still can't understand. I would never, ever want to put a parent through this. I mean, being in a theater with those fucking Oogies singing and all coked up and shit, and then you got to be in a theater full of screaming kids too. I would never want to put a parent through that. This is bullshit releasing it to the theater. Other than that, full price for kids who are 4 years old, as long as you can keep that shit at home.
What's your rating?
No, it's bullshit.
It's bullshit. I was about to say, all I heard was full price.
Yeah, I know. I'm saying it's a full price experience at home for kids who want to watch it.
Yeah. Is it honestly a full price experience at home?
If you're 4 years old, hell yeah. You lose your fucking mind watching this.
By that logic, anything is a full price experience at home.
This isn't anything though.
No, really. I gotta tell you something. I feel bad even giving it bullshit because I feel like, man, if y'all had marketed this to show this at the IFC theater in New York, like some if you had marketed this to like some crazy fucked up like parody of children's films to independent movie artists, they would have bought that shit. They would have thought it was ironic.
So you just repackage it, you take it to Sundance, and you have Mark Duplass just pop in a few scenes here and there.
Yes, you have somebody to come out. You really do have David Lynch come out and say, this is the most incredible parody of children's movies I've ever seen. People will eat that shit up.
You already have Chaz Palminteri doing his thing up on the screen, singing and dancing, making milkshakes. I mean, what else do you need?
If I was Chaz Palminteri, that would be my excuse. Mm-hmm. I would come out and say, oh, they told me this was a comedy, a parody of children's movies.
Yeah, I thought I was making a fucking hipster.
A German avant-garde
hipster
film.
Shit. Yeah, I thought I was making some hipster shit.
Yeah, you know, they were serious?
Yeah. This movie's only a problem if your kid ends up eating your face at the end of the movie. That's the only time. That's when it'll be rushed out of the theaters. Yeah, but man, no, this is, it is one of those things where I got so hyped and so, like, just... almost crazy to like get there, because as soon as I saw the trailer, I left to go see the movie. I had to, because I was looking forward to a crazy kind of Teletubby experience under the guise of a kid's film. So I'm surprised like I didn't find more people like around their 20s, you know, fucking just stoners who ain't doing shit, who have no job, just hanging out in the theater watching this shit.
Because they got to drive to the theater.
That's right. They're calling everybody looking for a ride.
Yeah, ain't no pothead gonna get up and make an effort to go see this shit.
It's like, dude, as soon as you get out here, I'll get my ass off this couch and I'm with you, man. We got to see this. But I mean, it gets ridiculous. I mean, just the lead actress who played the Dottie chick, Cloris Leachman, they painted her up like Betty Davis in Looking for Whatever Happened to Baby Jane, where they have a close-up of her where she has like red polka dots. Like, it looked like that bitch went crazy and got red lipstick and smeared like red polka dots on her face, looking in the camera like she's on her last leg.
She
probably
saw the footage of this movie before her parts came out. I signed up for this.
Oh my god, like her panties were on too tight or something, and it was like, man, what the hell doing? What do you got this lady doing? But I mean, the insanity of this movie, I mean, it's something I've never really seen before. But it is some old bullshit. At the end of the day, when you think about kids watching this shit, I'm like, you know what? At least some kids shows, you get something out of it. You learn something. You ain't learning shit from this movie. Who are you trying to kid here? No, man. This is some old bullshit. I almost give this some of my old diarrhea milkshake kind of bullshit. Well, you spread your cheeks real wide, and then you squirt in a cup too tight, going ew, 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 ew.
Oh, did I fail to mention that everywhere they go, they got creepy stuffed animals hiding in the bushes going like...
No, that wasn't. Okay, those weren't crazy animals. That's shit we were fucking looking at. That was us. Hallucinating that shit.
Is that a stuffed squirrel?
The Oogie Loves in the Big Balloon Adventure. This adventure doesn't start until you join in the fun.
I can hardly wait.
Only in theaters, August 29th.
Oh, sorry.